instrumental in motivating others to come. On Sundays, we have several that have been inspired to invite, to reach out and to invite others. I think it's because of their efforts that we can see an increase, I mean, not just this Sunday, but in several past Sundays. So we want everyone that was instrumental in getting visitors here today, we just want you to stand and kind of introduce those that you were able to persuade to come today. We really appreciate your efforts, and several of you have been very active at this. And we just kind of want to recognize your efforts, and we just want you to just have a word and introduce those that you are have here today. If you want to mention those that you had a couple of Sundays ago, or any time in the past, you may also feel free to do that. All right, so y'all want to stand there, or you want to come down?
Months ago, and I had my prayer and confession, and I, you know, was ministering to my son, and she wanted to see it, so I let her see it, and she didn't want to give it back. So her and a nurse that was on station there, we ended up having church in my son's room. And so she's been looking for a church where she can be taught. She has quite a knowledge of the word, but she needs guidance. She needs to be grounded. So I told her this is where, you know, she needs to be. So
amen.
She's here today, her and her son.
Sundays,
and we're not sharing the word of God. And, you know, and I took that to heart. And I said, well, Lord, who can I reach? You know, and then I read it to them after he had the message. So I know God had that set up. So I just want to thank him for that.
Amen.
Everyone, those that's here because of Sister Judy, we want you to stand. All right. All right. Do you have two more there, Sister Kamala? Okay, didn't stand? Okay. All right, they're going to stand. That's her daughter and her left. Daughter and son, right? You definitely okay. All right. Well, thank God for all of you again. And we want to just give you a scripture in 2 Corinthians 5:11 so that you can understand. And many times people get kind of get out of shape when people apply too much pressure or people are overly persuasive in terms of reaching out to them. So we just kind of want you to understand God's disposition toward this and what God is requiring of all of us. And we really desire for many of you that were persuaded to be here today to become fishers of men as well. So this is something that we feel that is very, very important. Okay, this scripture, 2 Corinthians 5:11, it says this, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. But we were made manifest unto God, and I trust also are made manifest in your consciences. Verse 14 says this, for the love of God constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. And that he died for all, they that which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. If we want to go down further to the 18th verse, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Chapter 6, verse 1. We then, as workers together with him, beseech you also that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. Amen. So that particular passage reflects much of what I'm going to be sharing on today. I'm just going to have a word of prayer, and then we'll just begin to kind of share some of those points that we just mentioned during the reading of the scriptural text. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you sent your word and you healed them. And that is the way that you bring healing, wholeness, and deliverance, even salvation to everybody else. The word and the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believe. And Father, we know that the word of God has the ability to transform men's lives, to destroy the works of Satan, pull down the strongholds of the enemy, and to undo everything that the enemy has done. Father, we thank you today that the Word of God is still living and is still working the will and the do of your good pleasure. And we give you the praise and the glory because we know that by grace we are saved, not of ourselves. It is the gift of God. Father, we thank you for all that you have done. We thank you for all of the blessings that you have made accessible and available to us through the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. Father, we thank you today. Ask you to lead and direct all that we say, all that we do. Let it be done to your will and to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. It was a couple of weeks ago, I believe it was Sister Hill that mentioned that we are, what you call flare raisers? Okay, we're the ones that wave the flare, the warning, as to the destiny of those that do not follow the will of God. So we're just watchmen, we are workers together with Christ. We are ambassadors. We are the ones that speak on the behalf of Christ. We're here in his stead, and we are to communicate to the best of our ability the provisions and the blessings that Christ has made for all of us through his death. And I think that if a person really understands what Christ has actually done for us and the extent of his love and the extent of his sufferings that he had to go through, I think it would be clearly understandable why the emphasis is so strong on the souls of mankind. It is really a very critical issue. It's something that every believer should be concerned about. I was just thinking about your closest of kin, those that you cherish, those that you love, those that's very dear to your heart. I don't think that you would like anything happening to them when it's in the power of your hands to prevent it. You know, I think that the destiny of all of us depends on the decisions that we make and the commitments that we make in terms of serving the Lord. So for that reason, we have to be pretty aggressive. I know that sometimes people think that we're kind of pushy. And why do you want to push your Jesus on me? Sometimes when people come down to the front, maybe they have to be persuaded or assisted to come to respond to the call of God. Many times they draw back. Some have even said that they didn't want to be displayed before all of the congregation. They didn't want to be put on front street. But the scripture says that knowing the terror of God, we persuade men. That we know the consequences of those that reject Christ or those that do not really embrace the things that Jesus has clearly said that is necessary in order for us to be received into the kingdom of God in the hereafter. Scripture says it's appointed unto man once to die. I think everybody understands that death is inevitable unless Jesus comes and raptures us. But after death, then is going to be judgment, and it's going to be a long eternity. You know, we only live to be 70, 80, many, you know, live a little longer. But what is even 100 years compared to eternity? And what you will actually be experiencing in eternity is something that you need to be really, really concerned about. So that is the reason, because there are many scriptures that tells the consequences of those that reject the gospel or those that do not live their life in accordance to God's will. So we just want everybody to be aware of the danger. And we gave the illustration several weeks ago about when part of the I-244 fell into the Arkansas River. Anybody remember that a few years ago? And when all of those cars just that weren't pre-warned, they just plunged right into the river. And they lost their lives because there was no one to warn them. No one held up a flare. No one had the opportunity to put up the danger sign or the warning sign before it happened. So we're the ones that warn people. How many understand that it's important to warn? And the Bible says warning comes before destruction. In most cases, I guess. And the Holy Spirit before fall. So we are not here to make life distasteful for you. We are not to intimidate you, but we are very concerned about your eternal destiny. Because it's going to be a long, long, long time that we will be spending either with the Lord or either alienated from the Lord. And what you do in this life, what do you do, are during the probation period that God has given us. The probation period we kind of categorize as the span of time that God has given us to fulfill His will, to carry out His will, and to do exactly what we were placed here to do. And I would say the most important thing God wants out of us is fellowship. I believe the most important thing that God wants from us is fellowship. Because if He can fellowship with us, if we can abide in Him, and if we can obey Him and do what He wants us to do and have a real intimate relationship or fellowship with Him, then it's something that will automatically compel us to do what He wants us to do. And that is the motivation behind it, our fellowship. The scripture says we were called into fellowship by Jesus Christ because Jesus wanted to commune with us. He wanted to reveal Himself through us. He wanted us to represent Him, and He wanted us to carry out His will here on this earth. So that is the reason why we are called ambassadors. Everybody say, I'm an ambassador.
I'm an ambassador.
That's the reason, that's the motivation, that's the reason you were created. You were created to glorify and to bring pleasure to the heart of God. I know that when we first experienced a child, our first child, when it first came into the world, our daughter was the first one, and we were just so delighted, we were so elated. I mean, it just gave us so much pleasure. It just was so fulfilled and gratifying just to see an image of ourselves projected in that beautiful baby. And I think that that's the motivation behind much of what we experience in families, is that we want our children to reflect our character, our values, our virtues, and the things that are important to us. We want to see that demonstrated, right, or manifested through our children. That's the thing that brings joy. That's the thing that brings fulfillment. That's the thing that brings pleasure. And we are admonished to abide in Him. That means have an intimate fellowship. Everybody just say intimate fellowship. Because see, if even if a couple, a family are intimately connected, they're going to have what? Fellowship with each other. They're going to know each other's heart, right? They're going to do the things that will what? Please them. And they will what? Actually be willing to make sacrifices and go through any length of trouble in order to what? Fulfill deep desires of that home. I know my wife sometimes, she knows me so well until I can just start a sentence and she'll just say, I knew what you were going to say. I can finish it out for you. And so that's the reason why God wants us to have an intimate relationship with Him, so that we would be obedient. We would, the scripture says, if you abide in me, my word abide in you, you can ask for whatever ye will and it shall be done. That's a big motivation for abiding in Him and having an intimate fellowship with the Lord, is that God will give you the desires of your heart. And bless us, God wants to. How many have children and with the purpose of that you were going to share some of your assets, some of your material blessings and the things that you have with them? That's the motivation. You don't want to live to yourself. You want what? Things that belongs to you. You want it what? Passed on. You want your family to enjoy. You want others to enjoy. So that's the motivation behind abiding in Christ. Because if we abide in Him, then we're going to what? We're going to obey. Is that right? We're going to carry out His will. Scripture says, it's God's will for all men to be what? Saved. Amen. And come to the knowledge of the truth. That's the purpose that we have set for this ministry. We want people to be saved, but we just don't want people to be saved and just show up on Sunday. We want them to come to the knowledge of the truth. Because if you are to duplicate what God has done, if you want that for others, if you want to be a true witness and win others, if you want to be the salt of the earth or the light of the world, you want that truth, that knowledge, that information, those blessings that you have experienced, you want those what? You want that passed on to others. So I think everybody ought to be looking forward to not only being saved, but what? Placing yourself in a position where those close to you. You know, the worst feeling you could ever experience when people that's close to your heart pass away, they go into eternity, and you know probably that their destiny probably was not the destiny that they desired. You can feel real bad about that. You can feel a lot of guilt around things like that. And you have a chance. And that's the reason why the scripture says, withhold not good from them to whom it is due. When it's in the power of your hand to do it. And God wants to place in the power of all of our hands to be able to what? Rescue those that's dearest to us. Those that we know, those that cross our paths, those that we work with, those that's maybe that's related to us, or maybe those that's a part of our family. The worst regret you will ever have, someone said that the pain of regret is much harder on you than the pain of discipline. The pain of discipline is a lot easier than the pain of regret. Amen. So for that reason why we try to do everything that we can, even we have Bible lessons designed on Wednesday morning, Wednesday night. We have teachings at other times, Sunday mornings, Sunday at the worship service, and even one-on-ones. We call up people on the telephone because we want people to understand that they have a responsibility to God. They're not just here to have fun. Amen. Wouldn't it be nice if all we would have to do is just have pleasure? Amen. And the Bible said, love not the world. Oh, everybody likes the world, right? Mostly. But the problem with that is knowing the terror of the Lord. We know that the scripture says that it's appointed unto man once to die, and after death, then the what? The judgment. The scripture also mentions that the here's the conclusion of the whole matter: fear God and keep His commandment, For this is the whole duty of man, for God shall bring into judgment every work, everything that we've done, God is going to bring that work into judgment. All right? For many, that judgment will be the white throne judgment. The white throne judgment is a judgment in which people will have to appear after they are resurrected to give an account of the life that they live in disobedience. This will be a terrible time because it will represent 1,000 years at least that you would have been punished spiritually for your sins, but then you will be resurrected to get a body along with your spirit and soul and to become accountable to God for the life that you live. That is called the white throne judgment. Everybody just said the white throne judgment. And we're trying to keep people from showing up at that judgment. I don't know what y'all understand what I'm talking about. We're trying to get people not to show up at that judgment. And the only way that we can get people not showing up at that judgment is that we have to warn them. We have to share the gospel with them. And after we share the gospel with them, then we have to We have to kind of be our brother's keeper. We have to be watchmen. We have to constantly remind people, whether they're on the wrong track or the right track or between the tracks or whatever. We have to We have to warn them all. And sometimes we come down pretty hard on each other because if believe it. Look how intelligent Sister Hill is looking. How beautiful she is. But we have to warn good people. Because sometimes good people will stray away. Sometimes they will get, she says she hasn't strayed. I mean, they could be discouraged. I mean, there are things that could really bring discouragement, frustration, and really get people distracted. Is that right? So I think we spend as much time, probably more time, admonishing believers. Stay on tracks. Be faithful unto death. Y'all hear that? Y'all come to church. Y'all be in what? Stop missing prayer. Make sure that you're in Bible study. You have to admonish people because many times people don't understand the consequences of their unfaithfulness because the scripture says that the battle is not given to the swift. The race is not given to the swift, neither the battle to the strong, but to him that endureth to the end. Is that right? He that endured to the end shall be saved. See, the prize is not given to the one that starts out and stops halfway the race. It's given to the one that endures to the end. So for that reason, we have to constantly admonish people that don't like church, that don't show up to church, that not used to coming to church. We have to warn them, and those that come sometimes, we have to try to get them more into the flow, and those that are consistent, we want to. So that is the motivation behind it. Now, the thing that I wanted to just kind of share with you, I'm not going to talk too much longer, about the terror of the Lord. Turn to Romans. You know, I don't like to talk a whole lot about the judgment side of God. But there's a judgment side of God that we have to let people know because these are going to be the consequences of disobeying God. I would like to stick with the love side of God. God is good, God is loving, committed his love toward us while we were in sin. When we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died, by grace we're saved, And that's not of ourselves, it's the gift of God. I would like to focus on Jesus becoming sin for us, you know, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. I would like to focus on that. But Romans 1, it talks about for I am not ashamed. This is Romans 1, 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth it, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. This is saying that nothing can change your life. Nothing can break the dominion of spiritual death and destroy Satan's power over your life except the Word of God and the Spirit of God. That's the reason why we share the gospel. We really, Sister Judith said that she'll like to, how did that, push? She don't want to be pushy, but she like to what? She like to push. She like to push. I don't know the difference. I guess there's a difference from the devil. All right. But we know that the gospel is the what? The power of God. When the gospel is preached, the gospel has the ability of what? To destroy all of the what? Barriers and hindrances and excuses and all that people use to what? To reject the gospel. Because it's power in the gospel. Amen. It's the power of God, the wisdom of God. That's the reason why we are not ashamed of the gospel. Okay, now look at the next verse. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. In other words, in the gospel, it tells you how you can be right with God. How your life can be absolutely what? Transformed. How Satan's power over your life can actually be what? Broken. How the strongholds of your life can be what? Pulled down.
Yes, yes.
How you can what? Avoid the consequences, amen, of sin and the destiny that awaits you as an unbeliever. How you can destroy or evade that. Amen. We ought to be shamed. We ought to be happy for somebody to what? To preach the gospel. Amen. But the real reason why many times people are kind of negative is because Satan has blinded the eyes of those who don't believe. Amen. When Satan blinds your eyes, you can't see the virtue of somebody sharing with you something that will save you from an eternal place of damnation. You can't really see that. But we know that, and God said that it's incumbent upon us to what? To reach out and to what? To warn. To warn, to put up what? The flag. Let them know that what? Danger is ahead.
Right.
The destiny, the path that you're taking is going to lead to death. And that's what the scripture said. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man. That's where Satan's blindfolders. How many know what blindfolders are? All right. When Satan has his blindfolders on your eyes, then there is a way that seemeth what? Right unto men, but the end thereof are the ways of what? Death. Okay, now look at the next scripture. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. When you believe the gospel, I don't care how long you've been living in sin, I don't care what hope the enemy has on your life, I don't care what predicament you might be in spiritually, the power of sin in your life is always broken. When you believe the gospel and act on the gospel, it's always... Is that good news? Scripture says that any man, it's age 22, be in Christ, he's a what? New creature. I can't explain to you how you can be a ranked sinner in one instant, and the next one you can be what? A totally new creation in Christ. I can't explain it, but that's the power that's in what? The gospel of Jesus Christ. You can become right in right standing
Amen. You can be on your way to hell. I mean, big time. But the gospel what breaks, woo,
hallelujah.
It breaks the dominion.
Thank you.
Amen. That's the reason why, amen, I always say, nature formed me, you know, mother's nature formed me, school informed me, the devil deformed me. But I went, amen, went to school and got informed, but I never got transformed.
Amen.
Amen. I know I met Jesus. Best thing that ever happened to me. And the second best thing was Jesus to me. I did have a girl once in a while. Oh, she said, I'd do that anyway. All right, now here is the thing, verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Now, this is the reason, this is how we get caught. Many times people go through life, sometimes nothing disastrous ever happened, never suffer anything fatal, never really have to experience major consequences out there, evil way. But the scripture says the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Now, there is a point that the cup of wrath gets to the point where it is, you know, filling up. And when the cup of wrath is filled, in other words, when the cup of wrath is filled, then God always what? Take action. Warning comes before destruction, taught his spirit before a fall. God never permits things to overtake you. Very seldom, person that haven't been warned, haven't been told, God hasn't dealt with them, very seldom or ever that ever takes place before a person's life is snuffed out. But one thing for sure, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven. In other words, God will show his displeasure with everybody that persists in sin and that totally reject and ignore the purpose and the reason why God placed you here in the first place. See, we were here to what? Glorify God. We were placed to what? To fellowship with God. To what? To carry out his will. To take Jesus' place here on the earth. Amen. And to make sure that the world is brought into what? Harmony with God's will. This is the reason why you are here. Amen. That's the purpose. Now, I think the reason why many times the women had a little problem with submission. Y'all had that discussion? Because they felt like men really didn't understand their purpose.
That's right.
And their responsibility.
That's right.
To what? Them and their family.
That's right.
And, I'm willing for them to raise the issue on Sunday morning. I'd like for y'all to present your case. A whole lot of women feel that what? Men really don't always step up to the plate, and then they want to what? Dominate me, tell me what to do, push me around, control me, amen, tell me what to do, and when they are not living up to what? Their responsibilities as what? The head of the house. Now, I kind of side with them. To a large degree. I mean, I was trying to figure out, I said, maybe we put some pajamas, Sister Hill out there on the front line one Sunday morning. Throw this out to everybody and let everybody just kind of evaluate the issues and see what we need to do here at Northside Christian Center. I imagine the brothers will have a rebuttal. Now, let me show you. Now, in this particular chapter in Romans, he lists a whole lot of things that God is really, really, he gets fed up with if we persist in them. Now, he's going to warn you. He's going to work through believers. He's going to what? Try to turn you around. He's going to try to what? Get you on the right track. But a lot of people are not going to what? They're not going to want to hear anything you got to say. But they just think that we're just a whole lot of what? People that's what? Trying to what? Get you in the church and get your money and stuff like that. But we're trying to what? Save you from an eternal destiny that's going to be very, very miserable. Okay, now, all of these things in the chapter, you can read for yourself. A whole bunch of things that God says that he is what? Because of this, I will be forced to bring what? Judgment. My wrath will be revealed from heaven against these. You're not going to escape these. Eventually, amen, the cup of wrath is going to what? Be filled to the brink. And I will have to what? Drop the hatchet. I will have to judge. You know, God couldn't be just if he didn't judge evil. Amen. How many know that there are some people that have done dirt to you? And you just pray that God will judge them. In other words, you're praying that you be vindicated. All right, Sister Smith, I want to pray for you. Will I have another chance?
Next Sunday.
All right. Okay. Praise the Lord. All right. Amen. All right, they had some appointment. Okay, now look at all of those things. Well, there's some ugly stuff in that chapter. And yet, a lot of those ugly things mentioned in that chapter are things that people are very comfortable in doing, and they don't want nobody left to mess with them. I like what I'm doing. Bible says that they that live in pleasure are you are what? Dead while they live. Right. But people like pleasure. People love rather than God. People love what? Love of darkness rather than what? Light. Is that right? Do I have that right, Sister Sharon? Men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. Is that right? All right, so what do you do when people like sin? They just like to do stuff. Some of them like the sexual perverted stuff. And dirty moves. I don't know nobody who do stuff like that. Some like to carry what? Grudges. Some people got, Lord, I'm going to get you if the last thing I do. Those are sins of what? Temperament. Some people just love idolatry. Everything comes before God. They might show up for Christmas service. They might show up for Easter. They don't like church. Men love what? Darkness rather than light. Because their deeds are evil. And if you listen to all, look at all these things here, I don't care how hard you try and how good you are, there's no way that God's wrath is going to what? Tolerate forever. And this is what the Bible says, he that is often reproved and hardens his neck shall suddenly be destroyed. Usually people that don't listen, they don't want nobody to tell them anything. If people persist on telling them, sometimes they just what? They just develop an attitude. Try to resist you. I know a whole lot of people saw me coming down one aisle and they started going down the other one. Men love what? Darkness. Rather than what? Light. Because they are what? Deeds are equal. Amen. I don't know anybody here. Amen. Praise God. Do all these things, but some of us do some of these things. And it's not the dirtiest sin that will send you to hell. It's what? Sin, period. Now, watch the last scripture. Who knoweth the judgment of God, they that witness, the last scripture, last verse 32. Who knoweth the judgment of God, that they which commit such things. If you want to know such things, talking about perversion, women, gay women, gay men, idolatry, sins of temperament, a whole lot of stuff. that explains where people live. Okay? They which commit such things are worthy of death. Not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that what? Do them. Okay, so that's kind of like the case. God's displeasure and his judgment absolutely are going to be what? Released. Because God cannot look upon sin with pleasure. He has to judge it. But he has a love side. How many left for the love side? And even the Bible says that when Jesus comes back to the earth for the second time, in other words, this is not when he comes for the believers the first time, but when he comes back to the earth to reign, the Bible says he's going to appear with all of his mighty angels, and he's going to destroy the disobedient and people that did not obey the truth. He's going to destroy them, amen, as he comes. I'm just going to just read that to you. It's really amazing how God's wrath is going to be revealed when he comes back to the earth, because everybody that have rejected him, that have disobeyed him, the Bible says in flaming fire, he's going to what? He's going to wipe them out. Disobedient. And I have the scripture, but we don't have time to do a whole lot of reading, but I just kind of wanted to you to see that in flaming, I believe. All right, praise God. Now, this is 1 Thessalonians 5. Okay, this is 5 till 4. Yourselves know perfectly by the day of the Lord, so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall set peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Amen. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, but that day shall overtake you as a thief. Ye are the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night, nor are darkness. Okay, there's a scripture which says that in flaming fire, this is 2 Thessalonians 1:8. In flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with what? Everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. And he shall come to be glorified in his saints and to be admired in all them that believe, because I have a testimony among you who believe in that day. So that shows you when Christ comes back to the earth, he's coming with vengeance. Everybody that have not obey during the tribulation period, that's going to be a time of what? Great sorrow. And all of the news and the things that's happening today are saying that we are approaching. Things that's happening in Israel is a clear indication that the time is what? Right at the door. And this could be in the next few years. It could be really quick. Now, the Israel situation is the time clock. That's when the tribulation is going to what? Truly end. That's when all of the saints are going to what? Just before then, the saints are going to be what? Called home. Amen. And 7 years of what? Torment, suffering, death. About 2/3 of the nation, of the world, will be what? Destroyed with fire, nuclear weapons. All of that stuff that we hear about in Iran and all of these nations that have all of this what? These nuclear weapons, all of this stuff is going to what? Be released at some point. 2/3 are going to be what? Destroyed. Flame and fire, taking vengeance upon all of them that what know not God, and they're going to be punished. Okay, but Christ has come to eliminate all of these things that which we describe as the destiny of those that what don't obey that what don't obey God. Christ has come to what eliminate that.
Amen.
And the only way we can what get beyond the punishment and all of the wrath and the things that are to come. That's what John the Baptist was crying out before Jesus came on the scene. He said, "Flee." If I told somebody, "Flee! Flee from the wrath to come," people think you what? A nut. They don't think everything's going to happen. They think everything is going to what? Be like it is now. Ain't no bad stuff. But this Bible is full of what? Prophecy. Boy, and we're at the what? Brink of eternity. If you ain't not concerned about your family, if you don't want them to get to the ark of safety, just don't say anything. Just don't say anything. Just let them go. And see who be boo-hooing in the final end. It will be much regret. Much regret. But Jesus has come that we might have what? Life. How many want life? And how many want to see others have life? That's the reason why the scripture we read, "He who knew no sin." Oh, I love that. He who what? Knew no sin became what? Sin for us. Why did he become sin for us? So that we might be made the righteousness of God. Not just declare the righteousness of God, but you will be what? Made. You become a what? Totally different being. Any man be in Christ, he becomes a what? I mean, this is a time that everybody ought to want to be what? Saved. And the reason why people don't want to be saved is that they love darkness rather than light. And the reason why they love darkness rather than light is because what? Satan has what? The blindfold us on. I don't care how much we shout. Danger! Flee from the wrath to come! Jesus is coming soon! Point unto man to die! After death, judgment, you will face a what? Judgment! That doesn't mean a whole lot. Because Satan what? And we just what? If we don't, if something don't wake us up, sometimes God will permit what? Something almost fatal?
Yeah.
Right? Sometimes he'll cause somebody to what? To be victimized by what? Some dreadful disease. And then people will what? Begin to what? I was a school teacher once, and one of my leading students, she was a pleasure seeker. And I was teaching school, I just shared to them. Then, I didn't know I could get fired for preaching in the classroom. But I preached, I took out a day almost every week or so, and I just did a little what, preaching or teaching like that. I got out of there, though. Oh, Jesus. And she was the kind that loved to dance. Ooh, some of y'all kind of like the disco, the dance, love the music and all that. Some of y'all like that, I guess. Oh, Jesus. Okay, but she loved that, and she just loved to do stuff like that. And one night, her cousin accidentally, he was handling a gun, and the gun went off, and she was shot. She died. That's the reason why the Bible says that we are not to put off tomorrow what we can do, what, but tomorrow what we can do today. Your wife, is not promised. The Bible says it's like a what? Vapor. Period for a time. Then it can be what? Snatched away. You don't have no assurance that this evening or tomorrow you will still be here. And that's the reason why the Bible says, must seek the Lord. While we may be found, call upon him while he is near. That the wicked forsake his way. And the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him what? Turn to God. God will have what? Mercy. And to our God, he will what? Abide on his part. So I just want to kind of reach out. You know, I don't want to force nobody to do things they don't want to do. And maybe many of you came just because of strong persuasion. But I want you to understand that it's time for us not just to come out of what? A persuasion of someone that we love that persuaded us to come. But it's time for us to come because we know that the coming of the Lord is near and your destiny might be into play even before Jesus comes. So I just want everybody to understand that today you have a chance. Tomorrow you don't know. When the influence is released, usually when the gospel is preached, the influence is what's present. In other words, God is saying, you know you need what? To change. You need the Lord. You need to what? Renew your relationship. But tomorrow, it'll all what? Be gone. And when the influence is gone, you can't get saved. You only can get saved when what? The Father draws you, the Spirit. Will not always what? Strive with men. That's the reason why the only time God promised to save you is the day you hear. Now is the appointed time. So I just want everybody that just want prayer for one thing or another, I just want you to prepare your hearts. We want to pray with you. And sometimes it might seem that you might say, well, I've got plenty of time. But the scripture says, remember now thy what? Creator in the days of thy what? You. While the what? Evil days come now, nor the years now. And thou shalt say. All right. Hey, now those from Koja probably know. Thank you. We grew up with that. Why do not do that? All right, so I just want to pray. Is there anybody that won't pray? So Pastor Hill, I just want prayer. I don't know what I'm doing in terms of living. I'm just kind of trying to feel my way. I have no directions. I don't know what lies ahead. I don't know what my destiny might be. But I want you, and I want the others in the congregation to join together and try to help me to get a grip on my life, get control of my life. And I just want the opportunity today to pray with you, because this opportunity might not be present. It might not be till next week even. Sometimes I don't even feel this way. Sometimes I don't even feel led to share things like I share today. So I just want those of you that really feel to renew your life, to renew your fellowship, to get closer to God, to make sure that your anchor holds and grips a solid rock. Those that feel a need, amen, to make Jesus the Lord of your life. I think today is the day. I think today is the day. Amen. Today is the day of salvation. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. If you want to get closer to God, you can even come. You have a special need physically for healing, you can come. If the enemy has place stumbling blocks in your path, you still can come. God is willing that none would perish. He wants all of us to come to repentance. All of us to come to repentance. Amen. All right, God bless you. How you been doing? All right, well, you're in the right place. This is the sister that lost her mother about 3 weeks ago. I'm so glad to have you back. Okay, well, we're going to, I guess everybody's in trouble. That's here. Amen. But we're going to pray that God will, amen, release you. Amen. All right. Is there any specific? Okay, let me get through. Okay. Okay, we just want everybody to stand wherever you are. These are precious souls that have felt the need to come to receive the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Scripture says God does not hear sinners pray, but if any man be a true worshiper and do it God's will, he'll hear. It's for God's will for you to believe and receive. Amen. Your salvation. Amen. Father, today, I'm trying to keep it with Lord Jesus. I have challenges in my life that I need to get me done. And I know you are the only way, the gospel of Jesus Christ is the only thing that has the ability to break the power of Satan over my life. Jesus, I take you as my Lord and Savior. I turn my back on Satan and sin and the world, and I want you to become the Lord of my life. I believe that you died for me. You became sin for me, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. When I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that you died for me, paid the price, and you rose again the third day to set me free. When I believe that in my heart, I say it with my mouth, the power of Satan over my life is broken. And I believe it. And then your power, your spirit comes in and makes me a new creature. So I believe now that you can break the power of sin. And I'm opening up my life to let you in right now. Come in, Lord Jesus. Save me. Deliver me from the power of Satan. In Jesus' name, I believe. I believe. And I thank you for becoming the Lord of my life. I believe now that all of my sins are washed away. I believe now that I am a new creature in Christ. Thank you for coming into my life, taking my sins away and making me a new creature. It's done. It's done. Thank you. And I believe I'm saved. I believe that I'm saved. In Jesus' name. Come on, just lift your hand and just pray. Thank you, Lord. Hey, thank you, Lord. Hey, 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 hey special prayer request, special need for healing. Bible says the prayer of faith shall save the sick. Any sick among you, let them call for the what? Elders of the church. And let them what? Pray.